Hello friends, welcome to the class of anatomy. Today we are going to study glossopharyngeal nerve. Myself, Dr. Sandeep Pakle, Professor and Head, Department of Anatomy, Rural Medical College, Raura Institute of Medical Sciences, deemed to be University, Loni. This slide or presentation is prepared from standard textbooks and reference book recommended by Medical Council of India and Praura Institute of Medical Sciences deemed to be university. Text diagrams used in this preparation are from the textbook of anatomy, Head, Neck and Brain, Volume 3, second edition by author Vishram Singh, which is elsewhere publication. And also Gray's Anatomy for Students 2019 elsewhere edition, otherwise mentioned on the respective slides. This presentation is only for the purpose of teaching students and not for the commercial. The specific learning objectives of today's session are based on the competency-based medical education AN35.7. At the end of this session, all the first MBBS students must be able to describe correctly functional component and nuclei of glossopharyngeal nerve. They also must be able to describe correctly course and relations of glossopharyngeal nerve, branches and distribution of glossopharyngeal nerve, and clinical correlation of glossopharyngeal nerve. If you want to study the glossopharyngeal nerve, the term glosso comes from the Greek word glossa, which means tongue, and the pharynx is the Greek word for the throat. It supplies tongue as well as pharynx and palate. It is a nerve of third arch. Type of nerve is mixed, which means it is composed of both motor as well as sensory fibers, but predominantly it is sensory. As you all know, cranial nerves are numbered from 1 to 12. Out of this 12 number, this cranial nerve, that is glossopharyngeal nerve, is 9th cranial nerve. First, we will see the functional component and nuclei. Here in this diagram, all the cranial nerves and their functional components has been shown. All the functional components are situated in the brain stem. That is, you can see this is the posterior view of the brain stem, which shows that midbrain with corpora quadrigemina. You can see this is the fourth ventricle, which is cavity of the hind brain. Then you can see this is a medulla and this is pons, and here the superior cerebellar peduncle. Here this is middle cerebellar peduncle and this is inferior cerebellar peduncle, which joins the brainstem with the cerebellum. Here cerebellum is taken out, and all the functional components of cranial nuclei, they are situated in the brainstem from medial to lateral in a column like manner, and this theory is considered as column theory. Now if you see the functional components, it can be categorized into motor nuclei and the sensory nuclei. In motor, they may be somatic motor, branchial motor and visceral motor or the parasympathetic. And in sensory nuclei, they are visceral sensory, special sensory and general sensory. So if we consider, this is the, on one side, if we show the motor nuclei, and on other side if we show the sensory nuclei. Usually they are present on both side, and there are pairs of cranial nerve, so each side contains both the component. So medial most is the somatic motor. So you can see this red colored column, which is the medial most motor, that is somatic motor. Out of that, midbrain contains the somatic motor component of the cranial nerve third, that is oculomotor and trochlear. Somatic motor means supplying to the skeletal muscle. Then pons contain the somatic motor component of the sixth cranial nerve, while medulla contains the somatic motor component of the hypoglossal nerve. So this red colored column is the somatic motor. Now lateral to that, you can see violet colored column, and this violet colored column is for visceral motor or parasympathetic. So from above downwards, midbrain, pons and medulla. In midbrain, this visceral motor or parasympathetic component is for third cranial nerve or the oculomotor nerve. And this nucleus is called as accessory nucleus of oculomotor nerve or the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. In pons, this visceral motor or parasympathetic component is for seventh cranial nerve, and the name of the nucleus is superior salivatory nucleus. Then in the upper part of the medulla, there is inferior salivatory nucleus, and which forms the visceral motor or parasympathetic component for the ninth cranial nerve or the glossopharyngeal nerve. And you can see here in the lower part of the medulla, there is a long elongated column, and this is called as posterior nucleus of vagus, that is 10th cranial nerve. It is also visceral motor or parasympathetic. Now the third component you can see here is branchial motor, and this branchial motor, you can observe here one part there is in pons, you can see motor nucleus of trigeminal nerve, then here motor nucleus of the facial nerve, and the third one is nucleus ambiguus, and which are for the glossopharyngeal and vagus nerve. On other side, if we study the sensory nuclei from medial to lateral, those are medial most is visceral sensory, which is rostral gustatory nucleus, and caudal visceral or the cardiorespiratory nucleus. Both these nuclei are for the nucleus of solitary tract, or we can shortly say NTS, nucleus tractus solitarius, and those nuclei are for the cranial nerve 7, that is facial, 9, that is glossopharyngeal, and 10, that is for the vagus. Now lateral to that, there is another nucleus, which is, you can see a big nucleus, that is vestibular nucleus and the cochlear nucleus, and they form a spatial sensory component for the 8th cranial nerve, that is vestibulocochlear nerve. And the last is general sensory, which is the longest column starting from the midbrain to the lower part of the medulla. And this is the general sensory, that means which carries touch, pain and temperature, responsible for carrying sensations like touch, pain and temperature. In this, the nuclei present are mesencephalic nucleus of trigeminal nerve, principal nucleus of trigeminal nerve, and you can see this is the spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. and all this is the longest column of the nerve or the functional component responsible for general sensation, and this is carried by the fifth cranial nerve or the trigeminal nerve. Now we'll see functional components and nuclei specifically for the glossopharyngeal nerve in toto. First component is spatial visceral efferent. Spatial visceral efferent, which can be abbreviated by SVE fibers. This type of fibers, they supply the stylopharyngeus muscle. The stylopharyngeus muscle, you can see it is a muscle developed from the third pharyngeal arch, and glossopharyngeal is a nerve of third pharyngeal arch. They arise from nucleus ambiguus. So you can see here, this is a nucleus ambiguus which is situated in the pons. So you can see this is a section of pons which shows various nuclei, like nucleus ambiguus, inferior salivatory nucleus, dorsal nucleus of vagus, nucleus tractus solitarius, and spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. Out of this, red colored structure is nucleus ambiguus, and you can see this is the spatial visceral efferent, or we can say branchial efferent component of the glossopharyngeal nerve. Now, the spatial visceral efferent or branchial efferent component, what it does? It is a motor to voluntary skeletal muscle derived from branchial arches. As the glossopharyngeal nerve is a third arch, visceral because it develops in pharynx and then migrate. That's why it is called as visceral efferent. And efferent means motor. And spatial means specially made for the branchial arches. So you can see the third arch is this one, and you can see this is the muscle of the third arch, that is stylopharyngeus muscle, which is supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. Now another component which is present in glossopharyngeal nerve is general visceral efferent. General visceral efferent. These types of fibers, they supply secretomotor fibers to parotid gland or parasympathetic to the parotid gland. They are preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, and they are coming from inferior salivatory nucleus. Now you can see this is inferior salivatory nucleus, and the component is general visceral efferent to the parotid gland. Now another is spatial visceral afferent, that is sensory. Spatial visceral afferent fibers, they carry taste sensation from posterior one third of the tongue. Visceral afferent means spatial sensations. Now here the spatial sensation is taste sensation, and the taste sensation from the posterior one third of the tongue are carried by these fibers, and also the circumvallate papillae, which are present in the just anterior to the sulcus terminalis of the tongue in the anterior two-third part. And these sensations are carried to the nucleus tractus solitarius. So you can see here the spatial visceral afferent or the taste sensation from posterior one-third and circumvallate papillae by this green color and carried to the nucleus tractus solitarius, again which is present in the pons. So this is a nucleus tractus solitarius. So spatial visceral. Now as I told you, the spatial visceral afferent, they are carrying the special sensation or the chemical sense that is test in the three cranial nerves. The vagus, which carries the posterior most part of the tongue, then glossopharyngeal, which carries the posterior one third of the tongue, and anterior two third is carried by the facial nerve, that is branch of the facial nerve, that is corona tympani. Now we'll come to the another functional component, that is general somatic afferent. Again, afferent means sensory and somatic means to the body. This general somatic afferent, that is general sensation, as we enumerated, that is touch, pain, temperature and proprioception. They carry proprioceptive sensation from stylopharyngeus muscle and also the general sensation from skin of the auricle. These sensations are carried through these general somatic afferent fibers to the nucleus of spinal tract of trigeminal nerve. Nucleus of spinal tract of trigeminal nerve. So you can see here the general somatic afferent from ear and also the proprioceptive sensation from the stylopharyngeus are carried with this yellow colored fiber, which are shown, and they are ending into the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve, that is general somatic afferent. Now another functional component which is present, that is general visceral afferent. They carry the general sensations of pain, touch and temperature from the mucous membrane of the pharynx, tonsil, soft palate and posterior one third of the tongue, and terminate in dorsal nucleus of the vagus. So you can see this is the general visceral afferent or general sensation from the viscera. General sensation from the viscera. You can see general afferent is the sensation, and you can see this is a visceral. So this component carries the general sensations of the viscera to the dorsal nucleus of the vagus. Though it is dorsal nucleus of the vagus, the fibers are coming through the glossopharyngeal nerve. So general sensations of the tonsil, pharynx and the tongue, that is posterior one third of the tongue, are carried through glossopharyngeal nerve to the dorsal nucleus of the vagus. Now coming to the course and relations of the glossopharyngeal nerve. The glossopharyngeal nerve arises from upper part of the latest aspect of the medulla, lateral aspect of the medulla. So you can see this is a pons. This is the ventral or anterior surface of the pons, and this is a medulla. Now you all know that the structure of the medulla and pons, this is called as pontomedullary junction. From the pontomedullary junction, the various nerves which are arises are abducens, facial, vestibulocochlear. And here the lateral aspect of the medulla, lateral to the olive, means there is a sulcus which is present between olive and inferior cerebellar peduncle. And this sulcus gives rootlets of the nerve, that is glossopharyngeal nerve, vagus nerve and hypo and accessory nerve, that is 9th, 10th and 11th nerve. While the sulcus which is present between the pyramid and olive gives origin to the rootlets of the hypoglossal nerve. So 9, 10th, 11th nerve are arising from the sulcus, which is present between olive and the inferior cerebellar peduncle. Between olive and inferior cerebellar peduncle by 3 to 4 rootlets. So you can see these are the rootlets. The rootlets unite to form a single trunk, glossopharyngeal nerve. After origin from the lateral part of the medulla, the nerve runs forward and laterally. The nerve is running forwards and laterally. So you can see here is the nerve. It is passing through the intermediate compartment of the jugular foramen. So this is the posterior cranial fossa, in which here you can see the jugular foramen. And through this jugular foramen, in the jugular foramen, there are three parts: anterior, middle, and posterior. And from middle, there are three structures which are passing, that is 9th, 10th, and 11th cranial nerve. From posterior compartment, the structure passing through is internal jugular vein. And from anterior compartment, first tributary of internal jugular vein, that is inferior petrosal sinus, that are passing through the jugular foramen. But the peculiarity of this nerve is it is enclosed in a separate sheath of dura mater. So it is enclosed in a separate sheath of dura mater. After coming out through the jugular foramen, so you can see here, this is the intermediate compartment. This is the jugular foramen. From posterior most compartment, you can see the internal jugular vein. Intermediate compartment, 9th, 10th, 11th nerve. Okay. So this is the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is in the separate sheath. The superior and inferior sensory ganglia are located on the nerve as it passes through the foramen. Superior and inferior sensory ganglion. The smaller superior ganglion lies within the jugular foramen. So you cannot see this superior ganglion. But you can see this is the inferior ganglion, which you can see after passing through the jugular foramen. This is considered as the detached part of the inferior ganglion only. Superior smaller ganglion is considered as the detached part of the inferior ganglion. Now this larger inferior ganglion lies just below the jugular foramen, and it contains the cell bodies of most of the sensory fibers of the nerve. So this is inferior ganglion, which is larger in size. After that, it then descends anterior to the internal carotid artery. From the jugular foramen, nerve passes downwards and forwards. So you can see here, it is passing through downwards and forwards, and lies between internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein. So you can see here, this is internal carotid artery and this is internal jugular vein. There is no this much space. This is just to show the diagrammatic representation of the all the structures. So you can see here, this nerve is lying between internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein. So after passing through internal jugular vein and internal carotid artery, it goes anterior to the internal carotid artery to styloid process, and muscles attached to it. So it goes anterior to the styloid process and the muscles attached to it to reach the lower border of the stylopharyngeus. So it is reaching to the lower border of stylopharyngeus. So this is glossopharyngeal nerve. Now, from here, it passes with stylopharyngeus. So you can see here, this is a glossopharyngeal nerve. This is internal carotid artery. This is internal jugular vein. The artery and the vein both are cut just to see the nerve. This is the posterior view of the pharynx. So you can see this is a pharynx. And you can see the styloid process as well as, and this is a stylopharyngeus muscle. So it lies here. So this is anterior to the internal carotid artery and posterior to this stylopharyngeus muscle. So you can see here the stylopharyngeus muscle and posterior to that glossopharyngeal nerve. So after coming to the lower portion of the stylopharyngeus, it passes through the gap between superior and middle constrictor of the pharynx. So in this picture, you can see this is a superior constrictor, this is middle constrictor, and this is inferior constrictor of the pharynx. And the nerve is passing through the gap between superior constrictor and middle constrictor along with glossopharyngeal. There is a muscle called as stylopharyngeus muscle. So here you can see. Then it curves forwards along the lateral aspect of the stylopharyngeus, which it supplies. Now, how it is terminated? After coming into the pharynx, what happens to the glossopharyngeal nerve? That is shown in this picture. Then the nerve passes to stylohyoid ligament and posterior edge of hyoglossus muscle. So you can see this is a hyoglossus muscle. And this is the posterior edge of hyoglossus muscle. So here it is coming the glossopharyngeal nerve. Here you can see here it is breaking into various branches. And these branches are called as terminal branches. And these terminal branches supply the mucous membrane of, you can see, this is the posterior one third of the tongue. Then it also supplies the pharynx and the tonsil. So terminal branches are supplying to the posterior one third of the tongue, tonsil, and the pharynx. So this is glossopharyngeal nerve. Now coming to the branches and distribution. First branch is tympanic branch. Again, this picture is only to show the diagrammatic representation to show the branches and distribution. So after formation by the rootlets in the medulla oblongata, in the lateral part between inferior cerebellar peduncle and the olive, it is forming, passing through the jugular foramen. In the jugular foramen, there is superior ganglion, then inferior ganglion. Immediately from the inferior ganglion, you can see there is one branch called as tympanic branch. This tympanic branch is also called as Jacobson's nerve. And this tympanic branch is arising from inferior ganglion of the glossopharyngeal nerve. This Jacobson nerve enters the middle ear through tympanic canaliculus. And this tympanic canaliculus is situated at the bony edge between jugular foramen and carotid canal. So tympanic canaliculus. After coming into the tympanic cavity, it forms the tympanic plexus. That means it is taking part in the formation of tympanic plexus, and this tympanic plexus is present over the promontory of the middle ear cavity. So you can see here the promontory of the middle ear. The tympanic plexus gives off many branches. Out of that, first branch is lesser petrosal nerve. So you can see this is the lesser petrosal nerve. This lesser petrosal nerve carries the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers which relay in the otic ganglion. So you can see here, this is lesser superficial petrosal nerve, preganglionic parasympathetic fibers to the otic ganglion, and postganglionic fibers from the otic ganglion, they are supplying to the parotid gland. The postganglionic fibers from the otic ganglion supply the parotid gland. So glossopharyngeal nerve plays important role in the parasympathetic supply to the parotid gland. This you have to remember here. Now, other branches are twig to tympanic cavity. Twig to tympanic cavity. Then you can see these are the smaller twig to the tympanic cavity here. Then twig to auditory tube. This is auditory tube. And a twig to the mastoid air cells. So in all, you can say tympanic plexus supplies four part. That is lesser petrosal nerve, branches to tympanic cavity, auditory tube, and branch to the mastoid air cell. So this is about the tympanic branch or the Jacobson's nerve. Now, second is, it is a branch to carotid sinus. So you can see here, from here the nerve now descends, lies posterior to, you can see the styloid process and the stylopharyngeus muscle. In the way, it is giving one branch to the carotid sinus. Here it is labeled as sinus nerve. So it is a branch to carotid sinus and carotid body. This branch serves as a afferent limb for proprioceptor and chemoreceptor reflexes from carotid sinus and the carotid body. Proprioceptor and chemoreceptor reflexes from carotid sinus and carotid body, responsible for maintenance of blood pressure and also the heart rate. So this part regulate the heart rate and respiration respectively. So second nerve is the carotid nerve or nerve of the hearing. It is a branch to the carotid sinus and carotid body. Serves as afferent limb for the proprioceptor and chemoreceptor. The third nerve is pharyngeal branch. So you can see here, this is a pharyngeal branch. This branch joins to the branches of vagus and cervical sympathetic chain to form the pharyngeal plexus. So this pharyngeal branch takes part in the formation of pharyngeal plexus. Other components of the pharyngeal plexus are branches from the vagus and cervical sympathetic chain. Now fourth branch is branch to stylopharyngeus. So you can see here, this is a branch to stylopharyngeus. It arises as nerve winds around the stylopharyngeus muscle, and it is considered as only motor branch to the glossopharyngeal nerve. Fifth branch is tonsillar branch. So you can see here, this is a tonsillar branch. It supplies the mucous membrane of tonsil and fosses. Fosses means depression where the mucus or the palatine tonsil is situated. And it also supplies the mucous membrane of the soft palate. So tonsillar branch supplies mucous membrane of the palatine tonsil, fosses, and soft palate. Sixth branch is lingual branch. which supplies the posterior one third of the tongue, and it carries the general as well as spatial sensation from the posterior one third of the tongue. So it supplies the posterior one third of the tongue and also the circumvallate papillae, which are just anterior to the V-shaped sulcus. This lingual branches carries the sensation, that is general sensation and test sensation, from posterior one third and the circumvallate papillae. So if you want to enumerate the branches of the glossopharyngeal nerve, they are: first branch is tympanic branch or the Jacobson's nerve, take part in the formation of tympanic plexus, gives various branches. One branch, that is superficial petrosal nerve, take part in the otic ganglion and supplies the parotid. Another branch to the tympanic cavity. Another branch is to the auditory tube, and one branch to the mastoid ear cell. So this is first branch. Second branch is carotid branch, which is also called as sinus nerve. Supplies the carotid sinus and carotid body, responsible for regulation of heart rate and the respiration. Then third branch is branch to the pharynx. This branch to the pharynx forms the pharyngeal plexus, and through that it supplies the pharynx. Then another branch is the branch to stylopharyngeus muscle, and this is the only motor branch. And other branches are tonsillar branch, supplying to the mucous membrane of the palatine tonsil, fossa, and the soft palate. And the last branch, that is the lingual branch, which supplies the, again, the mucous membrane of the posterior one third of the tongue and the circumvallate papillae. So these are the six branches of the nerve. So you can see all these branches in this diagram as well. So this is the stylar process. You can see the tympanic nerve coming from the glossopharyngeal nerve and forming the tympanic plexus in the middle ear, giving one branch to the lesser petrosal nerve, then otic ganglion, preganglionic fibers, parasympathetic fibers to the otic ganglion, and postganglionic are supplying to the parotid gland. Then branch to the auditory tube or pharyngotympanic tube, branch to middle ear cavity or the tympanic cavity, and branch to the mastoid ear cell. Okay. So this part is enlarged here. Now second, you can see here carotid, to the carotid body and sinus. Third, you can see to the stylopharyngeus. Then fourth, you can see to the formation of pharyngeal plexus, that is pharyngeal branches. Then palatine or tonsillar branch, supplying to the palatine tonsil, fossa, and soft palate. And the last one is the posterior third of the tongue, lingual branches. Coming to the clinical correlation of the glossopharyngeal nerve. The lesions of the glossopharyngeal nerve are rare in isolation because its course is along with the other nerves, that is 10th vagus and the 11th, that is accessory nerve. It is often associated with involvement of vagus nerve. As I told you, both are coming together. However, complete lesion of the glossopharyngeal nerve will result in loss of functions, various functions, as we saw in functional component as well as in the branches and distribution. So there may be loss of taste and general sensation over the posterior one third of the tongue. There is difficulty in swallowing and loss of salivation from the parotid gland, and unilateral loss of gag reflex. There is another term known as glossopharyngeal nerve or the neuralgia. Neuralgia means pain along the distribution of the glossopharyngeal nerve. This is also rare but sometimes may occur. This glossopharyngeal neuralgia is characterized by paroxysmal attacks of intractable pain in the area of sensory distribution of glossopharyngeal nerve. For example, throat, tongue, and ear, and which are precipitated by swallowing. And this is called as glossopharyngeal neuralgia. Now, testing of the glossopharyngeal nerve. It is also called as clinical testing of the glossopharyngeal nerve. So this nerve, glossopharyngeal nerve, can be tested by eliciting the gag reflex. What do we mean by gag reflex? On tickling of the posterior wall of the pharynx or soft palate or tonsillar fossa, there is reflex contraction of pharyngeal muscles causing gagging and the retching. Because this nerve is supplying to the mucous membrane of the pharynx through pharyngeal plexus and also the mucous membrane of the soft palate, fossae and the tonsil. That's why if we tickle this part of the mucous membrane, there is reflex contraction of the muscles leading to gagging and the retching. It can also be tested by testing the test sensation in the posterior one third of the tongue. So this is clinical of the glossopharyngeal nerve. So in short, studied the glossopharyngeal nerve, it is a ninth cranial nerve. This ninth cranial nerve is coming from the medulla oblongata through various functional components that we saw. After formation of the nerve, it is passing through the jugular foramen intermediate compartment. Here they form two ganglia, smaller upper one, larger lower one. After formation of the glossopharyngeal nerve, through this lower larger ganglia, one branch goes to the tympanic cavity and this is called as Jacobson's nerve. After that, it lies between the internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein. That means it is anterior to the internal carotid artery and posterior to the internal jugular vein. Now it descends along with vagus nerve. In the way, it supplies to the carotid body and carotid sinus, and this is called as sinus nerve or the carotid branch. Afterward, it lies posterior to the styloid process and stylopharyngeous muscle. Along with stylopharyngeous muscle, where it also gives branch to stylopharyngeous muscle, then it goes into the pharyngeal cavity through a gap between superior constrictor and the middle constrictor. After coming into the pharynx, it goes anteriorly. Here it gives terminal branches. One is pharyngeal branch, other is tonsillar branch, and third one is the lingual branch. The pharyngeal branch takes part in the formation of pharyngeal plexus and supplies the pharynx. The tonsillar branch supplies the mucous membrane of the tonsil, fossae and the soft palate, while the lingual branch supplies the posterior one third of the tongue and the circumvallate papillae. So that is all about the glossopharyngeal nerve. Thank you.